repertoire, a few reflections on the notion of repertoire. In sociolinguistics, so ever since the beginning of modern sociolinguistics, I'd say half a century ago in the 60s, the notion of repertoire has been an important one. Notably in the work of people like John Gumperz. All right. It was important because it enabled social linguists, you know, to describe the collection, if you wish, of linguistic resources that an individual or even a community, you know, would have in the way of languages mainly. And so the idea was that the notion of repertoire would describe the languages that an individual had within his or her control. So for instance, a multilingual individual would be able to speak or to use English as well as, let's say, Spanish, as well as French, and so on and so on. Okay? And in that sense, you know, the repertoire of a multilingual person would be different from the repertoire of a monolingual person. And in that sense, of course, you begin to realize how important this notion of repertoire was. So ever since the beginning of modern social linguistics. However, the strange thing was that in spite of its importance, and this notion was never seriously theorized. And so it was mainly used in a very superficial, in a very under-theorized, almost impressionistic way. Right, as if no deeper or more detailed reflection was needed, indeed was even thinkable. So we used to be satisfied with this very superficial notion of repertoire, at least most of us. I wasn't. In my view, there was a lot more you could do with this notion of repertoire. For instance, when you started describing new forms of multilingualism in an online, offline environment and in an environment which we called super diverse. Right? We needed, or at least we were able to use the notion of repertoire to design an analytical instrument that had a lot more precision and accuracy, and in that sense also validity. And for me, basically, two interventions were essential. First, we needed to expand the scope of repertoire way beyond the traditional use of repertoire as a thing that had to do with languages, all right? And in my view, for instance, repertoire stands for the collection, the aggregate of all meaning-making resources that someone has, okay? So not just languages, but also jargons, dialects, particular registers, also not just languages in a spoken form, but also, you know, different forms of literacy, very important, of course, in the online world. And so a repertoire is not confined to languages. We can use that notion to describe stuff, resources that are far more specific, a lot more specific. And that basically include every, you know, instrument that we developed and that we acquired or learned in some way for reasons of meaning making. Okay, that was the first intervention. Broaden the scope, make it a lot more precise. Then secondly, be also a lot more precise with respect to acquisition and with respect to let's say, differences within the repertoire. So the second intervention basically has to do with the fact that I see repertoire as a form of biography, an indexical biography, right? And that's basically the definition that I use for myself. A repertoire is an individual's indexical biography. What I mean by that is that this collection, this aggregate of meaning-making resources that we acquire throughout life, we always acquire it in the context of biographical circumstances, specific situations, all right, and environments and chronotopes in which at some point we got involved. For instance, your repertoire in a particular language, take in my case, for instance, Dutch and or English, would be deeply influenced by the level of education that you and also the specific type of education that you had in your life. Would also be influenced, of course, by your specific forms of mobility throughout life. Okay, it is clear, for instance, that a number of the little bits of language that are in my repertoire, for instance, Swahili, all right, have to do with the fact that at some point, you know, I studied Swahili and that I went there on numerous occasions and learned how to use that, you know, at least highly specific forms of that language. Okay, so here's an exceptional thing in the sense that not many people who have the same social-cultural and historical nationality profile than me, here in my country, in my neighborhood, not many of them would speak Swahili. This is unique for me. It's part of my biography, and that's why it is in my say repertoire. So we are able also to look at the stuff that is in our repertoire as traces of unique moments in life, unique, let's say, configurations of trajectories in life. And in that sense, they are biographical. They are indexical as well. So the biographies we can identify on the basis of an analysis of repertoires are indexical as well, because the stuff we learned in these particular environments in life, in these particular circumstances, biographical circumstances in life, okay, are, or at least they have to do with resources, all right, but also in the sense of how to use these resources, all right, what they are useful for, and what happens socially whenever we use them. So we learned, for instance, how to distinguish an insult from a compliment, all right, and we also learned about particular words, you know, that they are improper in particular forms of social environment. For instance, using strong language is heavily dispreferred in particular forms of social environments. You're not supposed to do that. Racist language, sexist language, and so on and so on. All of this is indexically marked. And so whenever we acquire resources in our biography, it's not just the resources we acquire, not just the forms of meaning-making resource, all right? It is that their actual indexical function that we also learn with them. So to summarize, when we now think about repertoire, we think about a repertoire as A, including all the resources that we, you know, have accumulated, okay, with the idea of meaning making, all of them, so not just languages, but also all kinds of different forms of meaning making resources that we have acquired. And secondly, we acquire them in the way or in the shape of an indexical biography. They're unique to us, right? They're very individual, okay? At least to some extent. And they're not just applied to resources, but also to the way in which we use these resources, the opportunities and the affordances of these particular resources. So think about it. Whenever you think about your own repertoire, it's usually a lot bigger and a lot more complex than what you write on an application form in that little block about knowledge of languages, all right? It's a lot more complicated than that.